Good evening and welcome to How to Build a Personal Brand. If you've ever wanted to understand how you can turn yourself into a bit of a brand, or if you've got a service or a product that's basically built around you, well, this is exactly the webinar for you. This is the one which will teach you about some of the principles around personal branding. At the end of it, you'll kind of decide whether this is something for you or not, because personal branding isn't for everyone. Some people just really don't like that kind of attention. And then there's show ponies like me who love that kind of attention. So as we go through this whole episode, hopefully you'll find where your perfect mix is and you'll get some clarity on how you could form your personal brand. I'm Dante St. James. We're going to get this underway. Thank you to everyone who's joined us online live. This will be recorded, so you'll get it sent to you at the end of the session. I'll also be placing it on YouTube at the end, a little bit, probably tomorrow morning. Actually, I'll do that because I want to get to dinner after this. So I'll put it on YouTube sort of early tomorrow morning, so it'll be available for you to reach there. If you are live on Zoom at the moment, you can message through the Q&A and through the chat window, or both open at the moment. If you're watching this later on through YouTube or through the recording, just either send an email and I'll have all those details at the end of the program for you. So let's share that screen and get it started. And let's see if you've got what it takes to have a personal brand. First up, a little bit of a quote from John Jantz from Duct Tape Marketing, which is a book I read many, many years ago, and which I actually really quite like the book, because it gave me a lot of insights into marketing on a budget, like basically using whatever you can find and whatever you got to work on a budget. The second reason I really like it, they've got a podcast now, and he does this weekly episode on the podcast, which brings together lots of experts from the world of marketing, and it's very much geared towards people like you and me, small business owners, rather than the big corporations. And personal branding, he says, is the art of becoming knowable, likable, and trustable. And they're the three items you really want to get in order to build a personal brand. You definitely want to be known, otherwise it's not a brand. You want to be liked, otherwise who doesn't want to be liked? And the ultimate thing is to be trusted for someone to make that purchase or to invest in your services or your products. This is brought to you by Business Station and the Australian government initiative called Digital Solutions. I'll have information later on how you can participate in that if you haven't already. As I said earlier, this will be on YouTube through my Business Station channel or through my own very own channel. So just look for either myself or the Business Station brand on YouTube, and you'll be able to look up hundreds and hundreds of different lessons just like this one, classes. I guess the beauty of that, when it being live, you get to ask questions along the way. YouTube, you have to wait until I actually notice the response and get back to you then. I'm usually pretty good, but like within 24 hours at least. What we're going to look at is what a personal brand is and why, especially now, that matters. Some great examples of people with personal brands, and some which, you know, maybe not the personal brands they were looking for initially. How you can start one, and then how you can build a personal brand, how you sort of build that out into something that's quite noticeable. Those of you who follow me on LinkedIn probably know I'm actually starting to build a personal brand of my own, because I think there's a market for pot-bellied, bald, middle-aged guys with beards who look like bikers presenting digital marketing tips. So I'm just thinking maybe I'll hop on the personal brand thing myself. A bit about me: my business is Clickstarter, DanteSt.James.com and Cellular One. I also got a cafe in Cairns and do a online e-commerce wholesaling business too. Other than that then, I've studied at University of New South Wales and Western Sydney University, done some TAFE micro-credentials, doing my Cert 4 in training assessment right now, which is a mess of head work at the moment, and also done a lot of other things that I'm involved in, and other things, other certifications such as the Meta Ranger certifications, from being a lead trainer with Facebook Australia through to being a creative strategy professional also with Meta. So first up, what personal brand is and why it matters. Why is there this need for a personal brand in 2022? And what exactly does that mean? Does it mean I was literally sticking a sticker on my head of a brand, or does it mean me stepping out and becoming the brand itself? It's a little bit of both, surprisingly. It's basically about what people say and think about you when you're not around. We call that a reputation sometimes, and certainly the reputation is part of a personal brand. We could call that, you know, feedback and recommendations are certainly the outcomes of a personal brand. It's about what you do, what you're known for, and who you are. And it all starts with your values, and we'll look at that very shortly. But when people Think about what it is you do and the things that they tell other people about you reflects what your brand is. Now, quite often we don't have a lot of control over that because we haven't painted a professional brand or a personal brand. All we've done is just done our work and hopefully people are going to say nice stuff about us. We don't have 100% control over that, but what we do have control over is how we perceive ourselves and how we present ourselves to the public on social media, particularly these days, and through everything from websites to the advertising we do on TV and radio, if it's something you ever get to do. Now, look at a few personal brands. Now, Kylie Jenner, one of the Kardashians, is known for reality TV. She's known for lip fillers. Anyone who's followed the Kardashians long enough knows that those lips didn't exist 10 years ago. They are fake lips. She's known for makeup. She's got a massive makeup brand. Is actually the first billionaire amongst the Kardashians. We know her for being fake. We know that everything is touched up in Instagram. It's all filtered and it's all airbrushed, and nothing you'll see about her is ever very real, because you'll notice that in Instagram she looks very different to when they capture video of her in real life. She's known for having a massive social media following, and she's also known for being very unfriendly and very unapproachable. Yet this is exactly what she wanted. She did not want to be seen. She wants to be seen as the new American royalty rather than as the approachable person you could walk up to and say, "Oh my God, Kylie, I love what you do. Please stop and talk to me." And she would. No, that's not Kylie Jenner. She's like the keep you at a distance, look up to me, but don't look at me. On the other hand, someone like Tom Holland, who's the latest Spider-Man. He's cute, he's sweet, he's polite, he's got that charming English accent, he's friendly and he's approachable, and he's the kind of kid that, he's not a kid, he's an adult, but he's the kind of guy who shows up to movie screenings of Spider-Man in various places around the world, and then just like sort of introduces the movie while everyone goes wild and goes, "Oh my God, it's actually you," or he appears after the movie to meet and greet people. He's just like, when he gets into this sort of stage of his, that's his brand. His brand is cute, sweet, polite, charmingly English, even though he uses an American accent in the movies themselves. Vastly different personal profiles, vastly different brands that they've got, but essentially incredibly famous people. Kylie Jenner, very famous, utterly unapproachable. Tom Holland would be someone who, if he sees a kid who worships the ground he walks on, he cannot help but go to that kid and give that kid the most memorable experience of their life just by shaking their hand or just by doing a Spider-Man move with them, because they worship the ground he walks on. This personal brand thing is really about what your colleagues and friends and family and others think of you when you're not around to defend yourself. So it's that thing, it's what do other people think of you? Quite often I know that when we go through a lot of personal development, one of the questions we'll often ask is like, what do your friends say about you when you're not around? What do the people who know you best and love you the most say about you when you're not there to fill them with the information, or they're not there for them to feel like they need to filter that information? And that's exactly what the outcome of a personal brand is. It's not necessary, like it offsets things like reputation, because a brand can override reputation. Kim Kardashian has a horrible reputation, but her brand keeps her relevant and strong and in the media and beloved by millions, even though she's got a terrible reputation and basically started out her career with a sex tape. But her brand over time has been able to gloss that over. Not every client I've worked with has loved me. Not every client I've worked with has been a success, but I have a brand that portrays that I do know what I'm doing. And I do know what I'm doing. It's just many reasons why a client may not like me, or we may not have been able to work well together, or something that has nothing to do with me knowing what I want to do. But my personal brand is one full of being able to educate people on how to use different things like personal branding, social media, Google, websites, all that kind of stuff. So my brand says one thing, even though one single person's experience of me may be different. I want to make sure that my brand is coherent enough and clear enough and consistent enough so that as many times as possible, the way that I portray myself is the way that people see me. And that's done through a bit of a process, and we're going to go through that. Now, the protest in you and the rebel in you, and it certainly did with me for a long time, says things like, "I don't care what others think of me. I just don't care. I'm not wasting time worrying about what other people think about me. I'm not going to be sitting here and obsessing over what people think." And that's very true. You don't want to be obsessive about this. What you do want to do, don't think about it as being obsessed with what people think about you. Think about it as you as a business owner having some level of control over what the market sees you as. Because what they see you as is what they're going to either buy or not buy. It's what the services they're going to use or not use. And when you're a solopreneur, when you're someone who's working on your own, you are the business, that personal brand is deeply, deeply embedded into what your marketing is going to be. You almost can't step away from it. A personal brand allows you to be comfortably in control of telling your own story, but not anxiously obsessed with what people think of you. So I don't want you to slip into that thing of imposter syndrome and thinking this is something you need to be obsessive about. I'm not obsessive about what other people think of me, but I'm obsessive about making sure my personal brand matches who I really am. And that authenticity is something we'll talk about shortly. The point is though, you already have a personal brand. People already have an opinion of you. People have already started making their mind up about who you are and what you do and how you do it. So whether you like it or not, you have a personal brand. Even if you're a shop, even if you're your name isn't your brand, people still have an opinion about what you are. They already have decided what you are, whether it's premium, whether it's cheap and cheerful or cheap and nasty, whether that brand is high end or very accessible, cheap or expensive. Those decisions have already been made in a lot of people, but you may not have had any control of that because you've never really thought about it. But when you have some control of your personal brand, you're able to, and this is why it matters, I guess, you're able to have that little bit of control. And that little bit of control over your personal brand allows you to design your marketing. It allows you to confidently network. It allows you to make social media posts that match who you are. And if you do the right thing with personal branding, as we're going to look at in a minute, you won't have to feel like you're faking it. And that's the best part, because your personal brand, because it's you and it's personal, it actually has to match what your true values in life are. And what they are is what comes up really soon. That's an absolute beginning, because there's such an opportunity, such a massive opportunity for you to stand out as who you are, because there's only one of you. Belinda, micro-credentials, Sian, I think it is. Sian, I think I got that right. Micro-credentials are like small courses, very, very short courses. Sorry, I missed that because it just showed up in the chat. And Belinda, you can separate your personal brand from your personal life. What tends to happen when you do that is that you tend to have what is called cognitive dissonance. So if they're definitely different, if your personal brand and your personal life are very, very different from what they are, then there tends to be I'm showing up as this, but that's not really who I am. And eventually you get caught out for sort of drawing that line between who you really are and who you're pretending to be. That said though, you don't have to bring your entire personal life into your personal brand. You don't have to tell every personal story of heartache and pain and all that just to get on. Sian, I thought I got it right, because I've actually asked you that before, Sian, about how to actually pronounce it. Now, the personal brand isn't necessarily everything of your personal life. So not every highlight and low light that's going to be there, but there should be no differentiation in what people think is between your personal life and your personal brand, because they are essentially the same thing. Remember, we're talking about family and friends is what they think of you, but it's also what customers think of you. Wouldn't it be horrible if you walked around and customers think you're amazing, but your family and friends think you're just a piece of dirt. And as far as they're concerned, you're a horrible person, but your customers think you're a wonderful person. What a weird life that's going to be. It's going to be like I call it a TV dinner life. None of your parts of your life touch, and it's all very separated. The peas are over here, the mashed potatoes over here, and it's all very, very, it's hard work to maintain that kind of thing. Take it from me, in my younger life, that's what I was like. Who I was to that is very, yeah. And as you're saying, Belinda, as an extreme introvert, that's hard. In business, you have to talk. But your personal brand almost does the talking for you. And that's the difference it makes. If you get the right idea on what your personal brand is, it will actually do a lot of the talking for you. Why it's important to have the personal brand is because nearly 35% of the Australian workforce now is made up of freelancers and contract workers. If you work in things like virtual assistants and those sort of things, your personal brand is just as important as what your skills are. the skills are the same as about 30,000 other virtual assistants, what will set you apart is you, what people think of you, what the world seems to think of you. Nearly 70% of employers now screen potential employees via their social media and Google searches. And I've done it before when I've hired people. The first place I go to, I look them up on Facebook, look them up on Insta, look them up on TikTok. And when I'm doing that, I know that everyone just goes, oh, you shouldn't be doing that. It's invasion of privacy. I'm like, it's a public domain. Those things are out in public. I need to know if this person is like, if this person is out on a Sunday night showing off an Instagram story and they're absolutely smashed, I've got to consider that maybe if they're doing that to their current employer, they may do it to me as well. So there's reasons why you look into that, because there's patterns that will merge. It's a story that doesn't get told in an interview. An interview is just a very artificial way of getting people to tell you a little bit about themselves. Their social media, if it's not locked down, will do the rest of the story for you. 43% of employers check on staff social media for compliance, because now if you think that, oh yeah, but that's on my social media, that's on my personal life, that doesn't count, that doesn't reflect on the company, I'm afraid there's already legal precedents that shown that that does actually reflect on the company, especially when people are doing things like very slanderous and very libelous things. It can be a very nasty connection. It's why your social media should be as private as possible, just to literally your family and friends, not to the open world. The average length of time in a job in Australia is 3.5 years. At some point, you, if you're working full time, will be looking for a job. But even you as a business owner, especially as entrepreneurs with very small businesses, we can jump from business to business to business in years, like very short amounts of time. In my first 5 years, I went through 6 different business ideas and then finally landed on one that worked, and now I'm working on 3 others. So it's always there's something else going on, there's some other way that people are going to learn about you. And it doesn't matter what those 5 different businesses are I'm working on, they all involve me. So at some point I have to sort of make sure that who I am to people in startups is what I am to people in corporate land, who what I am in government, to what I am to people who are looking to hire me to run their events for them. Whatever those places are, they still have to be me. Doesn't mean they have to know every single thing about me, who I date, where I go to dinner, whether I prefer fat milk or thin milk, or you know, Pepsi Max or Coke no sugar. It does, and it's Pepsi Max, by the way. But that's not the stuff that I'm talking about. I'm talking about here that who you appear to be when you show up to every part of your life is consistent enough that it feels trustworthy. So, examples of great personal brands would be people in Australia. I reckon Marie Kondo. So she's the organizational queen, if you haven't come across her before. She's that person who they say, you know, you throw out things that do not spark joy. So of those paintings on the wall, if one of those did not spark joy to her, she'd throw it out, get rid of it, and replace it with something that does spark joy. It helps you to declutter, basically. I'm just moving house in this next week, so I'm going through that process now, particularly with clothes. Clothes, not so much sparking joy, because I don't think any of my clothes spark joy. But what I would say that any of my clothes, if the clothes I haven't used in 6 months, I'm probably not going to use them again. So they go off to the St. Vinny's or the Salvo's. Same thing with anything in your life. Now, she formed a personal brand by dressing consistently, tidy and neat. She's got that cute Japanese giggle thing. She's got a very consistent approach. She always looks flawlessly groomed and always presents in the same similar way, and always presenting on organization and decluttering. That's what she does, is what she's known for, and that's what she continues to do. Her personal brand matches what the TV shows have, and from what we've been reading about her is that this is what she's like in life. She's not a TV character. She was like this already, and so when they brought her in the TV, she didn't have to act, because she was already that very organized, perfect posture, very much someone who you'd think had gone through June Dally Watkins finishing school, that kind of thing. She was very much already that person, so there was no cognitive dissonance, and that's a term I'm going to use a lot. There's no stress between who she is and who she's pretending to be, because she's not pretending to be anyone. Another person I think is awesome at this is Gary Vaynerchuk. He swears, he's potty mouth, he's kind of very, very direct with things. He's got this whole thing with the hustle culture and working hard and all that sort of thing. And some people can't stand him, but some people love him. I quite enjoy his stuff, and I like to drop in on his content quite regularly to see what he's talking about now, which is usually the same thing. And every time you see Gary Vee show up at a conference, show up on video, show up on radio, on a podcast, he is always that same person with the same set of messages, the same attitude, the same approach. Now, he can jump from a podcast, which is going out to a lot of adults and be dropping F-bombs all over the place, but then he'll be in front of high school students and he won't do that, but he's still the same person with the same personality type. He doesn't change from one place to the other. Brené Brown is a brilliant modern success story when it comes to personality and personal brand. She is, as a professor in her particular area, she understands psychology, understands growth, very good for people who are looking to start up female-led businesses. Just incredibly inspiring and smart. The communication style she uses is so clear, so concise, and so actionable that women and men both think she's brilliant. I don't know of too many men who've seen her who thinks who don't like her. Men love her because she's so, at the same time as being so empathetic and full of understanding, she's also able to communicate clearly. That's values that come across in her. That's her personal brand. So what I'm saying is all these things don't change. And then people who went through university with her say that's exactly who she is. She's always been like that. There's nothing different about her on stage than what there is in real life. And then I use an example like in Australia of a Queenslander, Lisa Wattigo. Lisa is one of my co-workers on the Facebook trainer group. And she is amazing. She's a First Nations woman who has designed her own clothing lines. She has organized, she was the inventor of Black Coffee, which is a networking group for Indigenous business owners all around Australia. She started many, many movements in trying to help Aboriginal businesses to recognize themselves outside just being painting and basket weaving. She was like wanting to move it out of that and show that there's so much more than just that. So she was a very good example of a personal brand, and I've met her in many stages, and she is unapologetically Aboriginal, unapologetically a woman, unapologetically the person who she is, and she's like that everywhere you come across her. It doesn't matter whether I've met her in person privately or in public at a dinner or seen her on stage, the same person all the time. You know what you're going to get. And all of these people are very clear about what they're about. They have a consistency of who they are when they show up. They show up as the same person all the time. You're not going to get this wildly different version of one minute they're like someone who's raindrops, lollipops, and rainbows, and then the next minute they're going to be like Satan. You get this same person every time. They're easy to find and easy to follow. These people have made themselves easy to find online, so you can follow their stuff, and then it's really easy to follow them. You get a lot of material on them on YouTube or Facebook or Instagram or LinkedIn or wherever you go to get your content. But one very important thing here is that they're not for everyone. Lisa's very much about that. She says, you don't like my message, don't follow me. Brené Brown, very much the same. It's like, I'm not for everybody, but those who I'm for, I'm absolutely love every single one of you. Gary Vaynerchuk says, if you can't handle me at my worst, just don't bother, because I'm pretty much always like this. And then someone like Marie Kondo is too polite to tell anyone that. But basically, if you don't like her, it's really of no consequence to her. So how do you know if you have a good personal brand? How do you personally know if you have a personal brand that's worth it any bit? Well, that's when we start to look at people not even realizing that you've moved to another workplace. Just say like, this is what I love is with hairdressers. Hairdressers can go from salon to salon to salon to salon, and they take their following with them. They take their fans with them. Now, what it is when people who follow them and love their work have not even noticed that they've gone to another workplace, to another salon, because they just follow them wherever they go. It's not something which comes up. They don't care which salon they're in as long as they keep following. That's a good personal brand. That's a hairdresser that people follow because they have a personal and close connection with that person. I've moved from one consulting company to another consulting company and no one really noticed because I kept presenting myself in the same way and making myself accessible so that it wasn't really even noticed that I moved from one to the other. I brought a crowd with me from one to the other, and it was a smooth, even success. Like, it was just a process that worked to be able to bring them across. That's the power of a personal brand. Sometimes it might be reflected in the fact that you're still friends with people you used to work with before, people with other workplaces. Now that's a good, strong personal brand, which says that you're the same person there that what you are here. There's no difference in person. You weren't like some super nice person there and you're a hard ass now, or the other way around, you're a hard ass there and you're a super nice person now. I'm still friends with people I used to work with at that particular one. In fact, I've got someone who I'm quite close to who we communicate daily on LinkedIn, who's still at that old company. So that to me is a sign that I've got a good personal brand. Same thing with you. Doesn't mean that, you know, you necessarily have to be friends with everybody from there, because remember what we said, these, you don't have to be liked by everybody. You just have to be liked by your target. And you know you've got a strong personal brand when someone comes to you to ask you for advice about your area of expertise. I get random messages from people on LinkedIn all the time asking me for advice about how to work with Facebook. That's me definitely getting my brand out there about being a Facebook professional. That's something I'm very proud of, that people will do that. I don't get annoyed by it. What I do get is, like, not everything I can fix, of course, but the fact that I've got that level of interest and that level of expertise with Facebook family of apps, it means that I'm communicating that correctly in my brand. I'm known for that. The other thing is that people refer other people to you without being asked to refer you. So you just get referrals. That word of mouth just happens when you've got a great personal brand. And that's because you're trusted. You are not just an expert, you're a trusted expert. There's a word going around now it's a term that's getting quite popular amongst people like accountants, business advisors, like digital advisors like myself. It's called trusted advisors. And that comes from a personal brand that says, oh yes, I've worked with this guy, you'd be able to work with him as well, he's awesome. Or she is my trusted advisor, pretty much I understand that everything I'll do with her, I know where it's gonna go, I know how it's gonna work, I know how the story's gonna end because I have an implicit trust with her because I've done so much work with her before. That trusted advisor thing, that's a valuable thing for someone to call you. So how do you take all this? And you say, well, now I wanna start this personal brand. First of all, we start off with what question is, what are your values? What are the things that are important to you that show up everywhere in your life? It doesn't matter whether that person is a member of your family, whether they are a potential client, whether they are someone in a crowd of people that you're talking to and speaking to in a public place, or they're someone who encounters you in the aisle of a supermarket. There's certain things about you that show up everywhere you go. And by showing up, I mean, they're obvious things about you. They're things about you that you are. You are that person everywhere you go. Now, some people go, well, of course I'm that person everywhere I go. That's who I am. That's what I am. That's not always the same for all people. Not everybody is that clear on what their personal brand may be. And they're certainly not that clear about what their values are. Your values are essentially these sets of all these words, and there's tons of them here. You can copy these ones if you like. These are just starters. You could be, if it could be very important for you that everything's done from a place of love first. And that's something which people would know about you. You could be a very organized person, and that's what you're known for, which then also means that it's important to you to be organized. That's one of your values. One of your values could be rugged individualism. Do you believe that people are responsible for their own decisions in life and when they get to, and there shouldn't be any excuses? People should be able to do that, and you are known for that. You may also be someone who's quite conservative, if that's your vision. You may be someone who supporting Aboriginal businesses is a massively important thing to you, or LGBTIQA+ businesses. Helping others is another value. So your values, remember this, they have to be present in every part of your life. So if you're someone who has a strong value of teaching others, but you quite frequently are turning away people, that you're like, oh no, I'm too tired after this conference, don't ask me questions at the networking. If you're that person, then teaching others isn't probably really a value. Like, we all get tired. We all get, you know, to the point where we're a bit done with our day. But if the opportunity to teach isn't a core value of yours, then that may not be the case. If you're someone who is highly organized, but you're always running late, then you're probably not highly organized at all. So that's not an area that goes across all of your life. That organized value is only kind of like, you may be wanting to be organized. And that's the thing here. These are not aspirational values. These are who you actually are. Because if you just do the things you'd like to be, like for me, I'd like to be wealthy, but I'm not. I'd like to be full of oh God, I'm really good with money, but I'm not. I'd like to be able to change the world, but I don't think I'm really changing the world. I'd just like to be able to just, you know, work with my niche and be able to change the lives of a few business owners. So if I say, well, I'd love to have all that, but reality is I'm never going to be those things, then I really have to go, well, is that a value that I have? Why do I talk about values in here? Because it's a very, very personal thing. Because this is who you're going to show up as. You're going to show up, and my particular values, I'll show you mine on screen now. My particular values are these. I want to show up everywhere I'm going to be honest, vulnerable, humble, and effective. I want to be honest because lying is just too much hard work. I did too much of it as a kid, and it takes a lot of work. I want to be vulnerable because people will find me open. So being vulnerable means I'm willing to share my failures and my successes. Humble means that it's not me just going, oh no, it's not as good as you think it is. Oh no, please don't tell me that was wonderful. You know, it was a team effort and all that. That's false humility. That's not what we're talking about. Humble is talking about the ability to go, yeah, I did a really good job here, but you know what? I couldn't have done it without these guys here who made this all happen for me. And that's being humble. It's saying that you have your limits and you're not responsible for everything that happened here. Others may have been. And effective is because I want you to be able to take all this and build your personal brand. If I'm not effective, therefore I need to change directions. So I have to ask myself every time I speak in front of a class, every time I produce a piece of social media, am I being honest, vulnerable, humble, and effective? And if I don't tick at least two of those boxes in everything I do, then I have to not do it. So if I'm not being honest and humble, or at least honest and vulnerable, or honest and effective, or something like that, in any combination of those four, I have to make a call on that and say to myself and say, well, that's not who I am. That's not who I'm being right now. So I need to either pull back and refactor myself to be those things, or I just go, don't do it. Just don't do that thing. Don't do that social media post if it doesn't fit those values. And so I've got those values written up at my desk on a post-it that sits right beside my desk, just right there. I've got one at my other desk at my other office, which sits in the same spot. And it just reminds me as a visual aid to make sure that every time I answer the phone, I see that. And I go, honest, vulnerable, humble, effective, which means I've got to be I can't be a dick. I've got to be a better person. So how all this can play out, let's just say that they're your values. How this plays out when talking with a colleague could be that in the honesty, it's saying to someone who's coming up to you and interrupting you at 11 a.m. right, you're in the peak of your work, it's saying, well, I really need to get this done. Can we talk about this at 3 p.m.? That's being honest, because the honesty is, yes, you could probably do this right now, but it would derail your day for the next hour. Like you'd have to spend the next hour catching up on where you got distracted from. So the honest person says, doesn't say something like, oh my God, stop annoying me. I haven't got the time for this. Honest says, oh, look, I really need to get this thing done right now. I've got a gap at 3 o'clock. Is that okay? And giving them an option. So you're not just saying no, you're saying not now. The vulnerability side of that is saying, look, I've got some family things going on. I'm a little distracted. For someone who's telling you that, hey, are you okay? You seem to be a little bit far away. Rather than going, no, I'm fine, which is not honest and it's not vulnerable, you would say there's some family things going on. You don't have to say what those family things are. You don't have to tell your life story. In fact, never tell your life story because no one's interested in it. It's boring. So we go, all I need to say is I've got a few family things going on. I'm a little distracted. You're not apologizing for it. You're not even, you know, saying, oh, look, I've got to pick up the kids at school for 3 p.m. Well, the husband's not really doing much at the moment. And oh my God, my mother's staying with me and it's just a nightmare. No one cares. That's not vulnerability. Vulnerability is just admitting that there is a reason and just saying there's some family things going on. I'm a little distracted. I'll be better tomorrow. Humble or humility is saying, thank you. I also want to highlight the rest of the team who contributed to this project. Effective is saying to someone that you don't want to just give them the easy way out. You don't want to say, look, there's this easy way of doing it. You go, well, there's an easy way of doing it, but there's also an effective way of doing it. Now you do the easy way and you probably won't get the result you want, but if you do the effective way, you've got a much greater chance. I don't like to give people easy solutions to complex problems because it won't work. I also don't want to give people complex solutions to things which are easy because that also won't work. I want to be effective, which means recognizing how I deliver what I deliver. how this plays out with a friend is saying likewise, that if they're wanting to have a bit of a whinge about their boyfriend or their girlfriend or their husband or the wife or their kids, they're like, well, would you like advice from me, or do you just need to be listened to right now? And I tell you what, when I do that, and there's a very honest thing I'll do with people, it disarms them. They're not expecting it. Sometimes they think I'm being a bit cold, but the reality is that I don't want to sit there and give them a bunch of advice they don't want, and they're just politely nodding their head. I really just go, look, I can give some advice, or I can just be a listening ear. And most of the time, 90%+, they just want to be listened to. The vulnerability could be, I'm struggling a little today, I just need some alone time. Humility, thank you, it means the world to me to hear that. Effective, if you like it, we can work on some strategies together. So rather than just simply saying yes or no, or you know, being angry with people, I want to make sure that I live out those values. Now, your values will be different, and how you live them out will be different. The same thing could happen if your value is to be, you know, maybe Australian made, that you only want to deal with Australian made stuff. So your values could be that you need to then explain how you use Australian products and how deeply that goes. Is it Australian products that have been repackaged into Australian products by Australian manufacturers and sold through an Australian company, or how deep does that go? And making sure, again, that if these are your values, you've got to show up as these things all the time. So you ask yourself, who do you want to show up as that is reflective of who you are? So this is a deeper question than it may seem. This is a business question, but it's a life question too, because you've got to decide whether the person you show up as in business is honestly who you are. And if it's not, and you're putting on a show, or you're putting on a fake kind of appearance to people, then that's eventually, that facade is going to crumble at some point. As soon as the hard times hit in a business, for instance, that's when it starts to fall. That's when the friendly, bubbly you is pretending to be friendly and bubbly, when really you're got an avoidant personality and you could be a bit introverted and all that. You don't have to be friendly, bubbly, very bright. Oh my God, I'm the life of the party. I'm not that person, and I'm gathering most of you aren't either. So if you pretend to be that person in your business, the minute that you're not like that, people notice. They go, oh, what's wrong with her? What's she doing? She's not right. And then they really start to believe, oh, maybe this is really who she is. She's just a fake person. And that's the kind of personal brand you do not want. Ask yourself who you are and what do you want to accomplish. This is important, because the question of who you are, not everyone knows the answer to that. And what you want to accomplish could be off in the future. But I think it's important, when you're forming your personal brand, before you're taking photos and making logos and choosing colors and deciding what you're going to be wearing as part of your personal brand, you need to do this background work. You need to take a very long, hard look at yourself in the mirror and go, who am I really? As opposed to who do I want to be? I may want to be happy all the time, but the reality is I've got some crap going on in my life that's going to mean I'm going to be under stress for a little while. So if I want to produce happy, wonderful posts and themes and quotes about how all this positive affirmation stuff, that's great on a calendar on your bedroom wall or on your kitchen wall, but it's not probably great for you to be posting in social media. I know it may be, you know, a statement of faith into what you want to be, but people will see you as that person. If they meet you and you're not that highly motivated, highly positive sunshines and sunrises and yoga on beach kind of person that you say you are in those posts, and they assume you are those people, then that cognitive dissonance pops in. Your cognitive dissonance, cognitive dissonance, hard to say quickly, it's popping up in you because you can't live up to that expectation of this person you're painting yourself to be. But then your customer, who sees you, who sees all this stuff that you're producing on LinkedIn and Facebook, and especially on Instagram, that's so beautiful and flawless, then they meet you and you're disheveled, you're in a bad mood and all that. That cognitive dissonance for them means that it's going, I can't trust this person. This person's not trustworthy. I don't want to work with them because they're fake. So think about what drives you. Your values are going to come out of this. What drives you? What are the things that make you wake up every morning apart from your alarm clock? If you were to leave your alarm clock off and you didn't have your calendar telling you what you were doing today, you just knew you had to go to work at your job or go to work at your business, would you be driven enough? If suddenly you weren't making money for a month, would you be driven enough to keep doing that thing? In what areas are you really good at? Are there things that you are super, super good at? I can do a lot of things, but there's a lot of things I can't be known for because they're just, I can't be known for everything. I've got to kind of niche down on my thing. And at the moment, I'm niching down on social media. That's my thing. Because the one thing I'm the most experienced at, I'm actually the most qualified and accredited person in Australia on social media. So, which is weird to say for some guy up in Darwin, but I've just done all the study. I've done all the certificates. I've done all the certifications. And I work for bloody Facebook. So it's like, of course, I've got some kind of expertise in that area. So that's an area I need to niche in. That's an area which I excel. So it'll be the same for you. That's an area where you will excel. What is your thing? What work drains you? What work builds you up? Think about what settings do you work best in? What industries you find interesting? Where you want to be at the end of your career? Do you want to be the person they turn to and say, okay, you're brilliant. Can you now train some other people to be brilliant? I think there's nothing better than the person who's been a practitioner all their lives at what they do, and at the end of their career, they're asked to train others to be also better. That is the ultimate compliment to me. I would love to do that. And that's exactly where I want to be at the end of my career, teaching other people to do the things I did. And what impact do you want to have? Do you want to have an impact on the planet? Do you want to leave your dent in the world? Do you want a legacy? Do you want a brand that goes on after you? Mary Kay Cosmetics. Mary Kay is no longer alive, but her name goes on. There's things like Maya. The Maya family does own that business again, but Sydney Maya, who first formed that particular company, is long dead, but his name still carries on. So your personal brand can have some legacy. It can carry on. Knowing who you are tends to attract people who are like you. So if you're sunshine and rainbows, you're going to have a lot of sunshine and rainbows people around you. You're also going to attract a lot of people who need sunshine and rainbows in their lives. If you are a natural skeptic and a cynic and you question everything, you will attract other skeptics and cynics around you. If you are a fan of Star Trek like I am, you're going to attract friends around you who also love Star Trek. Wish that was more true because I could use some more friends to watch Star Trek with in Darwin. These are people who are driven by many of the same passions you're driven by. Because they recognize that in you, because your personal brand is saying that you're interested in those things, they'll come to you as well. Oh, you're really into social media and you really love Facebook and I can see that. So how do I do better on Facebook? They'll come to you and actually ask you those questions. They're likely to follow you. They become fans because it's very clear to them who you are, what you do, and then they can see themselves in that. So a personal brand isn't just about what you portray. It's very much about what they see. Third, what are you great at and love doing? And this is from a thing called Ikigai. It's like a way of pulling out the difference between what things you are great at, what things you're good at, what you can get paid for, and then you find this sort of central thing, which is the thing you should be doing with your life. It's a Japanese thing, Ikigai, I-K-I-G-A-I. And so look it up. There's plenty of examples. You can do it online yourself. It's just literally like a Venn diagram where these things are in common. What are all the things that are in common in there? And you find it. So we want to find out, what are the things you're really good at? So if you're really good at making handmade soaps and you absolutely love doing that, that's a good place to start. That could be a good place for your personal brand to be. You're the handmade soap person. You are the organic ingredients handmade soap person because it's clear to everybody that you're someone who's into organic ingredients and it's very important to you because that's what your social media keeps saying about you. And then when someone comes to your house and goes to wash their hands after going to the bathroom, they see that you've got an organic handmade soap there. There's no cognitive dissonance. There's actually satisfaction. You are who you say you are in the real world. You live that life. It's someone who you are. That's a solid personal brand. So if we look at, if you're great at something, you've got credibility in it. When you're great at something, you tend to lead by example. When you're great at something, you can teach others how to do it. And you're seen as an expert, right? But then if you love doing it, that credibility is offset by enthusiasm. You're not just good at it, you feel good about doing it. You're not just leading by example, but when you do lead, you communicate clearly because you're not just good at it and know what you're doing, you love doing it. And so that communication is not just garbled and trying to make up something on the spot. You really, truly love this thing. When you're great at it, you can teach because you're consistent. Because you're consistent and you love doing it and you're always rocking up to do it. If you're a potter and you like to work with clay, you'll always do that. Throwing clay on a wheel is so therapeutic for you and you love doing it and therefore you've got really good at it. that great at it, love doing it thing comes together to form something you can be really well known for. Number four, what is uniquely you? What is it about you that's different? I was talking about it before, like what are our specific strengths? You could be good looking. You may be, you have this beautiful face, gorgeous eyes. You may be someone who works out constantly and be great looking, but that may not be your strengths. Your strengths could be you're highly organized. Your strengths could be that you are very good at grooming yourself. You're very good at speaking. You're very good at writing. So these strengths, the adage of saying you should always play to your strengths is kind of true. The things that you're good at and the things you're very strong at. So for instance, one of the things I'm very good at is being on time. I'm very, very prompt. I live by a calendar that tells me where to be and when and who to be with. It's got, if you want to go on a date with me, man, you got like about a 3-week wait until I can catch up because my diary runs my life. My calendar makes me be on time for all sorts of things. So, because I've got a busy life, I make sure that I'm on time where I can be because I like to respect other people's time. But with those strengths, then comes the idea that, okay, are they things that show up in all my life? Because yesterday I was late to something. I was late to go to dinner. So I arrived late to that dinner, 5 minutes late. Mind you, it was nothing bad because I was actually still the second person there out of 10, but I was still late for dinner. And I had to look at that and go, if I'm glad that that being prompt is not one of my values because I failed on that one very much so. But I was brought my values into that. I'm authentic and vulnerable. Yes, I'm authentic. Yeah, I was late. Yeah, I got caught up because of life. Took longer in the shower than I thought. Took longer to get dressed than I thought. And then, I got kind of locked in a YouTube hole. I'm humble in saying I'm not going to blame this on anyone else. It was all me. If you want to know what your strengths are, think about the things that you get complimented on. So the work you do that you always get compliments on, things that you've excelled at in the past, you might have even won awards for them. Or go so far as to say that, you're better at that stuff than most other people are. That's not necessarily being boastful. That may be a fact. You may actually be the best person in town at flower arranging. And that's a good thing to know that. If people have told you you're the best, then you probably are the best. Your personal brand says that this is the best person for flower arranging in our town. So the key is, if you've got these strengths and they're things that you love and that you do, then you've got to start talking about them. There's no use me going, oh yes, I'm a social media professional. I know what I'm doing. I'm one of the most, if not the most credentialed social media professional in Australia right now. Oh, ha, ha, ha. That's great for me to do all that and say all that. But then I have to start talking about that. I have to, they say you go like stop talking the talk and start walking the walk. Well, in the online world, you've actually got to stop talking the talk and start talking the talk. You've got to go out there and start to produce content that talks about that, writing articles, blog posts, making video. I've got to make a little bit of video every weekday. I've got to write a blog post every week. I've got to write social media posts every week that talk about my area of strength. I get social media. I get what it is. I get understand it, but I also understand how it applies to small businesses. So I've got to talk about that. Otherwise, my personal brand doesn't mean anything if they think my personal brand is talking about personal brand, when my personal brand is actually he's a social media guy. And it took me a long time to settle on that because, to be honest, I didn't want to be the social media guy because I felt like, oh, it's too niche. I want to be known for more things. But the reality is I need to be known as a social media guy because I can be specific about how I solved problems in the past. I've got that track record. I can show how my unique skills save the day with so many clients. And I can be saying like what it is about me that helped them win the day. Because that thing, my personality traits is I love, meanwhile, I'm talking my head off here. I actually love to sit down and listen to people talk about their businesses and their goals and their hopes for the future because it gives me so much fuel to help them to go, now I know what to do. Now I understand what your approach is going to be. So likewise, be specific about how you solved problems in the thing that you're really good at. Show how your unique set of skills and experiences help save someone's day in their business or in whatever they're doing. And then talk about what it is about you that helped them win the day. Like I've spent tons of time talking about myself in this webinar. I'm surprised you haven't gone to sleep. But it allows you to then understand, he knows what he's talking about because he's giving examples. Yes, I'm talking about myself, but I'm also talking about my clients. The next stage in understanding your personal brand is understanding who your audience is going to be. Who is your customer? Who is the person that's going to watch your stuff? Who's the person that's going to read your stuff? And we look at that in understanding there's a very big difference between a generalist and a specialist. A generalist has a very broad area of interest. Let's just say fashion. So someone who has an interest in fashion, that's a very broad area of interest. And in that very broad area of interest, there's many, many, many other people who also are in that area of interest. But then we go, okay, from that broad area of interest, who are the specific type of people who I want to be able to talk about this stuff with, to them to know me as the expert in that broad area of interest? And then once I've discovered who that person is, what's the niche within that, the specialized area of expertise? So what does this mean in the real world? Let's paint a picture about the idea that if you go out there and you pick broad stuff, but it's mostly saturated. If I just go for, I am a social media professional. Well, so what? There's 50,000 of us in Australia. What I want to do is go, I am specifically trained and certified and geared to get the most that you can out of Facebook and Instagram. So that's like a lot of people who are, but that's my niche. That goes from 50,000 down to maybe 15,000. People get paid more as specialists than they do as generalists. Generalists may get a lot more work, but that work isn't worth as much as what it is for specialists, because you had to study a lot harder and a lot longer to become a specialist. So if we look at that whole thing, if you say that in my broad area of interest, I want to help women, well, so does a lot of people. But then you go, no, the specific kind of women I want to work with is women from migrant backgrounds. Now you're starting to niche it down a bit. Oh, I want to help women, especially women from migrant backgrounds. Great. What do you want to help them with? What's the niche? I want to help women from migrant backgrounds gain employment in Australia. Now you've got something which you can be an expert at. Now you've got something to talk about. So if I say, I want to help small business owners, then the next thing is, who struggle with technology, to thrive in their businesses because they understand and can leverage that technology to make things work. That would be my little statement to make. You'll have a similar one. Who is it you want to help? Who specifically amongst that big group of people do you want to help? And what do you want to help them to do? And then that's what you start building your personal brand around. That's what you start creating social media posts around. Not about programs and courses and products. You start posting around that, because then you're talking to that person. So whether you're selling scented candles or business coaching, it doesn't matter, because you're talking to someone about something that they are interested in because they're so specific. It's not just, I want to make scented candles. It's that I want to make scented candles out of organic ingredients that help people to sleep better at night. Perfect. There's your niche. That's what you can talk about. That's what you become known as. Your personal brand is the person who makes scented candles for people who struggle to sleep better out of organic ingredients. So it's not just your personal brand has to be more than just the scented candle lady. You have to be a little bit more niche and a bit more having an effect on that. Now, bringing your brand online, that's a pretty big step. I know for a lot of people who are very introverted, this can be really scary, but you start with something like your personal website. Now, this is a bit different maybe than say a business website. I've got a business website, clickstarter.com.au. I've got a personal website, dantesandjames.com. Now, they're essentially the same set of services, but I'm sort of moving into being known for my name less than what my other brand is. The other brand will continue on, but my name is what I'm going to get hired for things I want to do in the state and overseas. So I had to create a personal website address. Now, you don't have to go super hard and create another WordPress site and spend another $15,000. You can do it through Google Sites for free, and you can just buy a $16 domain name and apply it to your Google site, and you've created a great little personal brand website that will get indexed by Google and will look nice. If you want to be a bit more complicated, you can use Wix to do that, but it'll cost you a monthly cost with it. Same with Weebly, it'll cost you a monthly cost to be able to apply that. Recently found a e-commerce store called Big Cartel, which allows you to have an e-commerce site for free, selling up to 5 items and have your own domain name on it, right? That's very rare for free things, for up to 5 products. So there's the ability for you to use these things for free. Just buy a domain name. That's the one purchase you'll make. and then connect yourself through to something like PayPal or to Stripe, and you'll be able to start selling things. But the important thing is, you may need to make that personal brand website. You'll buy your domain name, which is your name. Buy your name if you can find it. If your name is Joe Blogs, try and find joeblogs.com. If you can't make it, then you find, you know, Joe Blogs Australia or joeblogssydney.com or whatever it's going to take to get that personal thing. I think for a personal brand, it's important that people can find you and find you for not just what you do, but for who you are as well. It's a chance for you. It's your home. You don't want your Facebook profile, your Instagram profile to be the one place where people go to be the authoritative position of who you are, because you have a bad day and you paste a bad thing on Facebook or Instagram, that stuff's on there forever. And also, if you're a bit more privacy oriented and your Facebook profile is locked down and no one can see your stuff, then there's no personal brand out there about you. There's no information about you. You can get to tell your own story on your own website. You'll include things like an about you section, a bit about your interests, your education, your aspirations for the future, some past experiences and your certifications if you've got them. Think of it like your own personal resume, but it's geared towards what you want to achieve from it. So you may link to your social media. You may have a value proposition. If you need to work that out, it's basically what's different about you. what's unique about you that stands out amongst others who do what you do. You may want to get a professional logo. I just went into Canva, picked a pretty signature style font and just put my name in it and just went, okay, that's my logo now. You might want to include testimonials, but you'll definitely need to have very clear calls to action. So ability for people to click here to contact me, click here to send a message, click here to send me a message on Messenger or something like that, having some clear calls to action. You don't want people to necessarily have to find you only, especially if you're working in this solopreneur space, you're the one person business, you're the one woman in this game and no one else is working with you, they're not gonna know your brand name as much as they're gonna know you. You have a market stand at the Saturday markets, you're gonna be known as, most people will know you as your name at the markets. Oh, it's Mary, the one that sells the crystals at the markets. They don't remember your Eternal Earth Heaven Crystals business name. They just remember Mary at the crystal stand, because you know, people buy from people. They don't buy from a brand unless they're looking for something very high end for a very big status symbol. Those people are going in the markets to see you at your stall to buy your crystals. And of course, those social media platforms, a bit of Facebook, a bit of LinkedIn, a bit of Instagram, and these days a bit of TikTok. I've had to sadly put myself on TikTok. I didn't really want to do it, but I'm doing it. I got a couple of thousand views on a thing I did the other day. Not really going into too much huge, massive detail with it, but you know, it's actually really nice that I actually picked that up and got to do it. I got to, you know, get my stuff in front of a couple of thousand people where normally maybe 26 people on Facebook would see it. If you're looking at where to get momentum as a personal brand, LinkedIn, if you're particularly selling to other businesses, gets a lot of momentum very quickly, and it's very, very appropriate for your career or appropriate for those who are working with businesses as their clients. It's also a little quick fact about LinkedIn. Out of the 800 or so million people that are on there, less than 6% of people post weekly and less than 1% of people post daily. So if you post regularly, you are one of the, like, you'll get tons more momentum with people viewing your stuff than what you will on something like Facebook, where there's 70% of people who are on Facebook are posting on Facebook, or Instagram even more so, where almost 100% of people on Instagram are posting on Instagram. It's very, very few people aren't. So that's a good place to get momentum for, especially if you're serving businesses. Make yourself a bit of a content strategy. Now, this is not about making a content calendar. It's just saying, who do I want to be? Do I want to produce photos? Do I want to produce video? Do I want to produce written words on there? And understand the limitations and the value of each of those things. A photo, yes, a picture tells 1,000 words, but a video tells 1,000,000. Words on a page don't work very well on Facebook and certainly don't work on Instagram, but they work very well on LinkedIn. In fact, written posts on mine outperform all my graphical posts and all my video posts. Whenever I write a story, it always outperforms the other stuff. Your profile, think of it as a long, drawn-out brain dump. So if you're writing a profile about yourself, it's to give yourself that idea that the stuff that's all up in your brain gets sort of put out on a page. So it's like, I can do this, 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 and this, and I know this about all this stuff. So when I talk about your profile, I talk about your profile a little bit on social media, especially on LinkedIn. On LinkedIn especially, that's where your profile is going, like, where have I worked? What are all the skills I've done? What are the things I'm known for? And making sure all those things are listed in that profile. But as I said, that's mainly in LinkedIn. So then the things you produce on that have to kind of match that background. If you've got a background in education and you want to talk about education, then talk about education and post stuff about education. But make sure you make your content, and this works for any kind of business. There's four really main areas of content. There's helpful content, there's actionable content, there's inspirational content, and there's entertaining content. Helpful content helps someone to save the day and win at life. Actionable content, that will help you to do something straight away. It means I can take this information and do something. How to make scones, great, now I can make scones. Inspirational content is where you walk away feeling better. You feel better about your day because someone's been able to inspire you. Entertaining content, which makes up almost all of TikTok, is about entertaining people and making them feel good, like taking a break from the day, giving them a distraction away from things. Number 8 is where we go to build a community. And this is like where your brand is so strong that people will follow you and they want to participate in areas with you. And when you build a community, you have this ability to share your stuff with many people. So you're one person communicating to many people all at once. And when you can build that community and you build groups in Facebook, particularly a good place for that, it's very easy to scale your business and your promotions up. It's very easy for you to, rather than posting this one thing that goes to 5 people, suddenly it goes to 500. Very easy to monetize that kind of thing. When you're in a community like that and people want to follow you, then they're much more willing to pay for things. Not all the time, not all people do, but they were never going to pay for you anyway. But you provide a much easier way to funnel people into paying for what you do. And you grow faster. When you work on groups and communities, you grow faster. I've built 3 networks in my hometown, which have allowed me to grow way faster because I'm able to get in front of more people in a way that's very helpful, very actionable. Sometimes entertaining, because I tend to take the piss out of myself a lot, but sometimes it's inspirational too, because I tell stories about people's successes. So, would you like to learn more about how to do this stuff with a guide? We certainly can talk about this through the Digital Solutions Program. If you haven't done it already, $44, 3 hours of me, or 3 hours of myself, and maybe an hour with me, and an hour with one of our other amazing people who work in this area of personal brand. Sarah Thompson in WA does a lot of work in personal brand. In Queensland, we probably have someone like, trying to think who our Queensland people are who would do personal brand. Maybe Renee Dombowski in Cairns would be very good at this as well. I certainly enjoy doing it. It's a lot of fun. So please, you can register for that if you need to at businessstation.com.au, or please just reach out to me. I'm more than happy to field questions about this stuff, particularly on LinkedIn, because I talk about it a lot. I'm on there a lot. But I'm also all over Facebook and Instagram or email. So please do reach out if you'd like to have a bit of a chat about personal brand and what your limitations might be, or trying to get past your limitations and take some control over the conversations that are being had around you, because you don't really want to have to rely only on word of mouth coming from people you don't know. You want your story to be told in the way you want to tell it. You want to be known for what you want to be known by, for. So take some time out, work on your personal brand, do some research, and hopefully it'll help you to feel more in control of what the world thinks of you and your business. Thank you so much for taking some time out of your Monday and spending some time with me. I really appreciate it. It's been fun having a chat to you. Please do have an amazing time tonight and for the rest of your week. And hopefully now that those public holidays are all over, we can get some work done. Be nice, wouldn't it? Thank you and good night.